Hey there, everyone. Thank you for tuning in to another week of Infosec 101's Teachable Tuesday. And we're here every week, Tuesday at 8 p.m. to provide you, and that's Eastern Standard Time, to provide you with actionable insights for those who are new to cybersecurity, trying to get their career started, trying to land that first job. And for those who have been in cybersecurity for quite some time, who may be looking for actionable insights and industry insights to make that next move in their in advancing their career. So let me tell you a little bit about how Teachable Tuesdays got started. And I'll back up a little bit to the Facebook group. So I started a group back in 2015 called Infosec 101. And the reason for starting that group was so that those who were new to cybersecurity could have a place where they could ask questions and interact with professionals in the field. Because I saw in some other, forums and things like that, I saw new people asking questions and they would immediately get flamed or cursed out, cursed at for asking, newbie and basic questions, or somebody with many years of experience would just, list out these 100 things this person needed to do to get started, you know, and it just seemed like a not so motivating or not so friendly way to welcome someone to the InfoSec community, or to kind of invite them to take a look, you know. So the InfoSec 101 group is there to meet that need, to provide a place where you can come and ask questions, ask the same questions that you would generally Google for. Of course, we're going to, send you back to Google at some point, but we also want to build a community and, you know, chime in with our own personal experiences and expertise to answer those questions. So in the InfoSec 101 group, we have newbies. We have those who have been in the cybersecurity field for a couple years. We have recruiters, those who are looking to offer jobs and giving strategies on how to land your next job in the group as well. We also have cybersecurity company owners who are providing the jobs and providing those valuable insights from a much higher level to let you all know what you're in for, what employers are looking for, and, you know, just a different perspective to make your insights that much more richer. We also have cybersecurity writers in the group and bloggers who are, keeping a beat. In addition to the recruiters keeping a beat on what's going on in the industry, the writers are keeping the group a beat on what's going on. And, making sure that we're up to date on the latest virus or attacks and what have you. So the group is a rich, valuable resource for you to continue to benefit and continue to strategize and build your cybersecurity career, or to determine if cybersecurity is for you or not. And out of that group came Teachable Tuesday. So InfoSec 101's Teachable Tuesday is just another added value, where each week I bring on someone in the cybersecurity community who's doing something awesome, who's doing amazing things in the field and continuing to contribute. And in that same spirit, looking to benefit the next person in cybersecurity, whether you are experienced in cybersecurity or whether you're just getting started. So this week we have Sean James on. And Sean James, he's been in cybersecurity for several years, or 20 years to be exact. And, he's has a bevy of experience. He's been at this in multiple levels of IT, as he was telling me about, and just an awesome, well-rounded background of experience, and also coming with the same spirit of looking to, make your career that much more richer. Sean, thanks for joining the show. How are you doing today?
Hey, too good. Good to be here. Thanks for having me. I appreciate that.
No problem. No problem. I appreciate you being available for today, and also for continuing to do what you do in cybersecurity as a instructor, with the wealth of knowledge you have with pen testing and all the other aspects of IT that you've worked in. One thing that we do on the show is, you know, no matter how many years someone has in InfoSec or IT in general, everyone is curious as to your route into the IT and into the cybersecurity world. Everybody's route is different, sure. You know, so I'm sure you have a story that goes along with how you got started. So let's hear it. Tell us a little bit about how you got started.
All right. So I guess, You know, I'm a bit older than some people. when I got started, it was actually, I think I was about 8 or 10 years old, believe it or not. And what I used to do instead of going outside and playing with the kids is I would take the touch tone telephone and hide behind the couch and start dialing star and pound codes and writing them in my marble notebook to see what they said and what they did.
Nice.
So I've always had that interest in technology and, you know, figuring things out, problem solving, puzzle solving, I guess. So that's kind of really where I got my start, and it really just grew from there. And as I got older, I got more into, you know, computers when they became more readily available, you know, and it's just progressed to a wildfire, so to speak.
Yeah. I knew you had an awesome story, something like that, you know, with you getting started at 8 years old, you know, who could imagine, you know, so your curiosity was sparked and, you know, was, you know, started very early on.
Yeah,
probably early. A lot earlier than a lot of people.
Right. Yeah, it was fairly interesting. I mean, I had no idea about pound and star codes when I was a kid. You know, and then I think I read it in a magazine that my dad had or something, or a paper or something. And I'm like, that, well, that's interesting, you know? And so I just started messing around with the phones, and actually the telephone company called my parents. I got busted. The telephone company called my parents and asked, what in the world are you doing with the star and pound codes? So my parents kind of figured me out. You know, they thought I had just like a little fort behind the couch or whatever, but here I am, star and pound codes for days.
Yeah.
So the phone company wasn't too thrilled about that. Then I got into more, as I got a little bit older, I got more into phreaking, which is telephone hacking, much similar as you've heard of Kevin Mitnick and some of the other names.
Yeah.
And that kind of piqued my interest too. And so when I was old enough to ride my bike on my own without my parents, you know, being with me, I used to go to payphones and start doing the same kind of thing and learning how to, you know, blue box and all that good stuff. So it was fairly interesting.
That's awesome. That's a great and rich experience to get started. Yeah. So from there, what did it look like landing your first job? And your first job was, I take it, in IT?
Yeah, it was actually grueling. I started in tech support, believe it or not. And I think that's where a lot of people, you know, they have this idea that they're going to immediately go become a pen tester or a blue teamer or something. And that's not generally how it works. I mean, maybe nowadays it's more available in terms of internships maybe or something like that. But I started in just doing basic tech support, like, you know, my keyboard's not working. You know, yeah, I can't print to the printer. You know, and I already had a wealth of knowledge before that. But the most important thing is you have to be humble and you have to start somewhere, gain some work experience, things to add to your resume. And while you're doing that, train on, you know, on your free time and try to better your career. And I think that's really where people should focus on.
Absolutely. What would you say is the foundation of your transition into the security side of things? What piqued your interest in security? Did you fall into it, or, you know, did you actually have your eye on it and say, I want to get into, probably didn't call it cybersecurity. It was probably something else when you got in.
Yeah, it was information security. And so, you know, really for me, it was just something that I always wanted to do. I liked messing with things, tinkering with things, breaking things, figuring how they work, how they don't work, what can I do to make them better, or, you know, what have you. So for me, it was kind of always this thing that was just like burning inside that I have to do security stuff. And then when I heard that there's a way, like I started out, you know, hacking stuff. And then, when I figured out there's a way that you can make money doing this, I'm like, well, I mean, what's better than that?
Right.
You know, I climbed my way through school and training and practice and my own training. And it just, you know, it takes time. It doesn't happen overnight, unfortunately. But with time, you know, and patience, and you can get there.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think that's part of the buzz and the craze of, you know, cybersecurity being in the news every day, is you start to see people who kind of get that bug to say, or that itch to say, oh, I want to be in this field, you know, because they're seeing the glamorous sides of it, you know, as it becomes publicized. And so you see people who want to get in now, and immediately they want to migrate from some other industry, you know, with no really solid understanding of IT, and they just want to jump in and, like you were saying, do the overnight, you know, success story.
Right. I attribute that a lot to movies and TV shows like Mr. Robot and, you know, the Hacker series of movies and, you know, the things you read online. It makes it sound so crazy and exciting and so easy. And it's really not. It's grueling work, a lot of dedication, and like I said, a lot of patience, you know, and just stay after it. A lot of people find, at least I find with some students that come to our training facility, is that it seems all glamorous and attractive to them at first because they've seen these movies and TV shows and what have you. But when they come in and actually realize that it takes real work, it's not easy by any stretch, and it takes a lot of time, patience, and whatever, they kind of decide it's not for them. And that's okay. We definitely don't need a bunch of people working in this field that hate their jobs. This is not a 9-to-5 job by any stretch. You could work overnights. You could get an emergency call in the middle of the night. Really depends on who your employer is. So, for me, I think that it's a good thing that the media has brought cybersecurity into the spotlight. But also, I think it's a bad thing because it kind of it doesn't really give people the real deal of what this industry is all about.
Yeah, absolutely. And with that, let's talk about some of the misconceptions, because I'm sure with all the students that you deal with, you know, day in and day out, you probably come across misconceptions that people hold when they're getting into penetration testing. What are some of the misconceptions that you have to kind of set people straight on coming through the door?
Good question. I don't know. You got about 6 hours? No, I think the most common ones that I hear are, of course, you know, well, Mr. Robot clicked a few keys and he was into the federal government's computer database and he hacked the world.
Yeah.
You know, that makes him feel like it's easy and it's not, which we've discussed. I think that the amount of online information there is, you know, random YouTube videos and blogs and, you know, whatever. I mean, there's a ton of training facilities out there. They kind of make it seem easy, but they skip over a lot of things. And, you know, the students sometimes come in and say, well, I know how to use Nmap and I know how to use Metasploit. I should be good. That's not what it's all about. You know, anybody can click a few keys and try to figure it out, but most of the time you wind up banging your head against the desk because you don't know what it takes to actually get to your goal. So those are two of the biggest ones, I think. A lot of people think that it's a 9-to-5 job. Another huge misconception is that everybody, again, thinks they're going to make money overnight. You know, they're going to make 100, 150K a year, like first year out of school. That doesn't happen either. I mean, you have to be extremely lucky for that to actually happen. You know, it takes years and experience. And I think that, you know, everybody thinks there's a real fast track to get there, and there's not. And even if you know a decent sum of knowledge, you don't know everything, and none of us do. None of us, not even the trainers, not any of the people that have been in the industry for 20 years like me. Nobody knows everything. You know, sometimes you forget stuff and whatever, but it's impossible to know anything or know everything. And so I think those are really the biggest misconceptions that I find on a daily basis.
Absolutely. And what would you say, someone getting into the field, and, you know, I always see $100,000 as that magic, you know, United States number as far as salary that people are after within the cybersecurity field. So what would you say is a reasonable timeline for someone getting, let's say, transitioning from being a physical security guard into cybersecurity? How long would you tell them to give themselves before they can expect to be able to command $100,000?
You know, that's a tough question to field, because it really depends on the person, and it depends on the amount of time and work that they're going to put into their training and their skill set and really sharpening their tools. You know, some people can get there in 5 years. Some people it may take 10 years. You know, I would say 5 years is a good number of, you know, getting some training initially, doing some self, you know, study and practicing, getting an entry level job and really kind of building your skills and your social network of, you know, other talented individuals and getting your name out there, being on Indeed.com and whatever else, job search sites, LinkedIn, whatever. You know, I would give it a round number of five, but like I said, I think it really depends on the person. And one other thing is that we get a lot of people that transition from totally different careers, have nothing to do with IT. Maybe they can even barely turn on a computer. Yeah. And that's okay. You don't necessarily have to have that background in IT or any kind of computer-based knowledge if you find the right training institute for you. I get that question, like I said, every single day, multiple times a day. You can really find good training that takes you start to finish. It doesn't right. have to be where, it's like a boot camp style thing where it's, a 7-day course and you're in a room with one instructor or two instructors for 8 to 10 hours a day. Those things rarely work. And I think that they leave people often more confused, especially newbies, often more confused than trained. So it's just really dependent upon the person and how much time and dedication you could put into it. I know people that have come into us that were doctors and lawyers just to get training in cybersecurity because they were kind of burnt out or tired on their career or in their retirement phase or whatever the case may be. And it really just depends.
Do you feel like, do you see those who are transitioning into the field? Is there a certain point where some of them realize that cybersecurity is not for them, or have you seen people just pretty much gung-ho and pretty much stick with it until they successfully land that first job?
Well, I've seen a little bit of both sides of the fence. I've seen people that transition from a completely different career that do figure out, hey, this is too much work. It's not for me. I can't remember things. And really, it's because they get down on themselves. Anybody that has dedication and passion and a brain in their head can learn pen testing. It just takes time. And so I think that part of that misconception of it being where, everybody thinks it happens overnight plays into the fact of why these people quit early. Now, there is some legitimate cases where they say, yeah, you know what? This is not for me. I'm good. And they go on down the road and do something different or whatever. But I've also seen where guys come from an IT background and they want to advance their career into cybersecurity. And then they're like, oh, this isn't, replacing keyboards and restarting computers and reinstalling operating systems. This is too much for me. And
right, they quit. Right.
So it really, from both sides of the fence, it does happen. And it's sad to see them quit, but ultimately it's their choice.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think that's something that people have to keep in mind, that this is a ever learning, ever sharpening, sort of field in line of work.
Absolutely. I mean, there's times where I still learn new stuff. I mean, there's new technologies, new techniques and new, approaches and different ways of doing things that come out every single day, multiple times a day. So it's impossible to, like I said earlier, know everything. So I still learn new stuff. I mean, I'm always tinkering with, VMs and different things and different technologies and different ways of doing things. I like to think outside the box, and that's kind of what I like to teach our students. Don't get trapped in that, one way to do things, because sometimes it won't work out for you. So, yeah, I mean, you always have to keep learning. This is something that doesn't go away. It's not like, a physician, for instance, where they graduate with their PhD and now they practice medicine for the rest of their life and they don't really have to go back to do any kind of more training if they don't want to.
Right, right.
This industry is ever evolving. There's new attacks and all sorts of bad stuff that come out, daily. So you kind of have to learn these things in order to be efficient and proficient at your job.
Yeah, exactly. And that's an interesting point you bring up about someone graduating with a degree in a particular profession or field and not really having to, not having a solid requirement to continue to upgrade and refresh that that knowledge. It's kind of like you get a degree and that's your stamp of approval for life to say you know a particular area. But within cybersecurity and IT in general, you always have to have that knowledge refreshed,
Yeah, it's always changing. And then when you think you kind of got it nailed down, it flips over and changes again. The idea is that dedication and understanding that from the gate, that this is ever evolving and ever changing. That's an issue with some, like these YouTube videos that you see, right? One guy does it one way, but maybe that don't work anymore. And you got to kind of try to figure out how to go about it a different way. And that's what I see a lot too is, I learned it this way. That's nice, but it don't work like that anymore.
Yeah.
You kind of have to adapt and change to your surroundings. And that's part of like anything, I think, but more importantly in cybersecurity, that's a definite.
Yeah. And I'd like to get your thoughts on a commonly misunderstood term within information security. How do you usually teach your students to think about the term hacker and the activity of hacking, as the term has been pretty much demonized in the media?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And I kind of like that one because we have been demonized for so very long. You know, back when I first started, everybody thought that everybody that knew how to hack into computer systems was Kevin Mitnick, right? Look at how his case went. They thought that the guy would blow whistles into a telephone from jail and set off nuclear missiles or whatever. I mean, that's just how bad that they demonized us and how misunderstood the general public, you know, was about this stuff. What I try to teach people is we're hackers, right? We know we're hackers. We break into things and make them do things that they're not supposed to. And that's what the definition of hacker really is. But we're professionals, right? We're all working towards either be certifications or, you know, career goals of whatever sorts. But we're professionals, penetration testers, information security professionals, whatever you want to call it. But don't ever, you know, go to a job and say, yeah, I'm a hacker. Or don't go out and, you know, say, well, I hack things, I'm a hacker. Right. That's all well and good, but we're trying to bring a better perception, I think, to the industry as a whole, so we're not so demonized. And nowadays, the media is actually helping us with that, right? So they say, you know, cyber criminals broke into XYZ and stole, you know, thousands of credit card numbers. And that's all well and good, but then they're also saying about how the good guys are there to protect us from the bad guys. And that's kind of where we come in. So if you really had to give it something to say, well, you just say I'm one of the good guys. I break into systems to help identify security weaknesses to build, you know, the systems better so the bad guys can't get in and steal your information.
Exactly. And it's, you know, it's unfortunate that that hacker has to be caveated that way to say I'm one of the good guys, you know, because the term hacker just scares people in general, you know, who just pretty much don't have that same understanding.
Yeah. And that's, you know, again, that's been going on since forever. You know, you say you were a hacker. I mean, back in the, you know, maybe the 60s and the 70s, I guess, you know, the term hacker was, well, I take computers apart, you know, and I make them do things and I mess with the circuit boards or whatever to make them do things that they're not supposed to. And that was good back then. Everybody kind of felt okay about that. But then when these people started doing bad things and quote unquote calling themselves hackers, that's when it really evolved into this bad term and, you know, all the badness that came along with that. And, you know, other professionals like myself have spent the last 20 years or so trying to undo that mess from a short period of time when it happened. I think if we just keep striving to say that we're, you know, professionals, which we are, I mean, let's face it, we're not doing this stuff to, you know, illegally break into companies. We're learning this stuff and paying to learn this stuff so we can actually turn ourselves into a career and make good money doing it.
Exactly. Exactly. So let's talk a little bit about this organization here, Pentester University. So what did you see as an issue in the industry that kind of triggered you to say, hey, there's a need for a Pentester University? So tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, sure. That's a great topic. So I started off while I had my pen testing firm. I kind of was, you know, browsing around the web. YouTube was starting to really come popular. And I was on YouTube doing security research, just checking out what people were doing, you know, what people are posting. And I want to kind of see the underground side of things and just to kind of understand things a little bit better for our company and our position in the marketplace. And I saw that there was just, I mean, of course I started on YouTube, but I saw that there was a ton of misinformation or disinformation out there. And the videos were terrible quality. They, you know, if the guy was speaking on the microphone, it was jumbled, marbled up and just a mess, or he was typing in a notepad and making 50 billion spelling mistakes and backspacing. And it was enough to like make you dizzy zooming in and out. And so I felt like, were people really going to this media outlet to find information on cybersecurity training or even, you know, whatever ideas, whatever. And I'm like, this is really terrible. So I started the NetSec Now series, which now has 42,000 something subscribers.
Yeah.
I think I started that back in 2013. And it took off like wildfire. I mean, everybody's comments were, wow, you speak English, you don't type in a notepad, your videos are of high quality HD,
right.
You know, and we actually can understand what you're saying, and you're not just throwing out a bunch of technical terms and making it a mess. So I kind of, you know, did that on the side for nothing. And then at some point I realized that, you know, there really needs to be more, because YouTube wasn't able to meet what I felt is demand, meaning organization, right? Mm-hmm. So I can make a bunch of videos and put them into a playlist, but I couldn't really convey and get one-on-one with these students or these people trying to learn. So I said, there has to be a better way. And I did a ton of research for about, man, if I had to say, I think I researched it for like a year, maybe a year and a half.
Yeah.
On how to actually put a platform together to make this happen. Now, sure, there's hosted things, and that's actually where we started, was with a hosted platform, and then we kind of did our own thing. And so it's really, it was to meet the need of the gap between YouTube and Google and kind of put everything in one place. Because the biggest issue I find is that, sure, you can go watch one YouTube video and then kind of expand on that and Google search a little bit here and Bing search there and whatever. But who really brings it together in one place, in one piece that you can actually understand? And then on top of that, who do you contact if you have questions, right? So there was a couple of other, and I won't name names, but there was a couple of other training places out there, but you couldn't get a hold of these people. Like, so if you have questions, what do you got to do? So for me, I'm like, I would really like to get that one-on-one connection with people and do the one-on-one private coaching, do group meetings, kind of like what you and I are doing on this video now. Do a group meeting with the students, give them all the information they need, and be there for them whenever they want. Sometimes it's really hard to get an email back from some of these other people or places within a week. Yeah, so for me, exactly. My goal is 24 hours. I have to get back to you an email or I'm not doing my job. So That's kind of where I tied everything in. And I really wanted to cut the BS, so to speak. You know, a lot of these guys are like, well, you just do an Nmap scan and then, you know, search exploit or whatever to find your exploits, or search in Metasploit or MSF console, pick an exploit, fire it, and bingo. And that's not really how it works. You know, what most people miss out on, unfortunately, is the phases of penetration testing. And you'll hear me say that in these groups day in and day out, every single day of the week, phases of penetration testing. And the reason is because that's the framework that you need to be successful in any attack. Right. And if you feel like you ever get lost in attack, just go back to the last phase of the penetration test you were in, and then you can't get lost. It's like a map, is the way I like to think about it. And so that's kind of what we did with Pentester University, brought all those elements together and really tried to make a real good go at helping people to actually understand it in one place so they don't have to run around the internet trying to figure it out.
That's an awesome idea, because there's a lot, like you were saying, there's a lot of dispersed information all over the web, you know, and you don't know if you're receiving quality penetration testing information. So at Pentesting University, does the training that people receive, does it what's the emphasis on the training? Is it to give people a solid, well-rounded skill set to do pen testing, or is it to prepare them for a particular certification such as OSCP or CEH?
That's a great question too, because we don't really prepare people for tests, but the information we have help people pass those tests, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I don't advertise like, hey, take this course and get your CEH right away, or go get your OSCP right away. What we do is kind of create a home base for beginners and even some, you know, professionals that have already gone a little ways into the industry and need refreshers or additional ideas or additional training, whatever. Create that base for them to really build off from there. So, you know, you get your pen testing course, we teach Linux, and inside of some of those courses are networking modules and all sorts of different stuff. So it's really a well-rounded place where you can go off and choose what you want to do next. You know, I can't say that, yeah, it helps you get XYZ certification or whatever, because that's not fair to students, right?
Right.
So, but to help them expand their knowledge, to help them pick a decision, make a choice, is kind of where we stand there. And we do have labs. Thanks, Alex. Appreciate that. We do have labs, and our labs are a little bit different than most other places, for security reasons and different things.
Yeah, how so?
They're good labs. So you have a couple of different options, right? So you have hosted labs like, I guess the OSCP does that too, but you have hosted labs where you log in over a VPN to, you know, some other guy's network and you're in there hacking, but you have 50 other people also trying to attack those same machines in that same address pool, right?
Right, right.
So the problem with that for me anyway, is that I'm logged into that connection. I pick up an IP address from their DHCP server or what have you. And I'm just another IP address on the network. So if somebody's doing a wide scan, let's say for instance, with Nmap, you know, just doing the whole subnet, they pick up my IP address. What's the chances of them accidentally or potentially attacking me?
Yeah, exactly.
And for me, that bothers me. I mean, not that, you know, we have anything to hide, but it's the abuse on the machine or your resources or whatever. Maybe they break into it. Who knows? Or you have places like VulnHub where you can download, you know, other people's VMs.
Yeah.
The problem with that, too, is you don't know what's inside that VM. You just don't. Right. So you could download that VM and maybe it has a backdoor in it. Maybe it was a malicious actor. I don't think that anybody really vets the VMs at VulnHub. I could be wrong, but I don't think they do. So where we come in our labs is it's a downloadable VM, but it takes place every week. And so you have a whole week to pen test this VM that I have personally vetted, checked out, made sure they're good if I got it from somewhere else. Or a lot of times I design my own VMs to really give students that idea of, you know, logical thinking and a logical approach to pen testing, because it's not all just point and click, right? You have to kind of use logic to apply it to really think outside the box. And so it takes place every week. And what happens is you get a VM and you're tasked with it. The first two or three VMs are to kind of gauge where students are in their learning, you know, because they go through our course. It's kind of like a course track. They do the pen testing course, the Linux course, the VI course, the whatever. They do all of them. And then when they pass their final exams, not only do they get their certifications from us, from me, but also then they go into the labs and it kind of helps gauge where their weak areas are and where their strong points are. And then I build a customized plan for each student based off of those first two or three VMs to try to work on their weak points and get them stronger in that aspect. So this one, when they do go out, there's not too much that's going to surprise them. So, you know, a lot of people do go off to do their OSCP. A lot of people do tend to go off and do their Security Plus or their CEH. And that knowledge that they gain there, I think, really helps them, because a lot of our students report back that they've passed their exams. Some guys don't bother with the exams. They just kind of go off into the world and do their own thing, maybe start their own company.
Yeah.
You know, so, yeah, that's kind of where we stand in the market.
I think that's a very significant point, that you're not necessarily preparing someone for or you're not preparing solely for a certification or exam, but you're focused on giving them pretty much the a very solid foundation, you know. And I think that that's very unique, you know, and this is the first time that I'm hearing of this. Usually when I speak to, you know, professional trainers, it's, you know, I'm preparing someone for an exam. You know, so I love that concept that you guys have picked it up and run with it.
Yeah, that's cool. I appreciate that. I mean, you know, just to touch on certifications as a whole, while we're kind of on the topic there, I'm kind of on the fence about certifications, and I'll tell you why. So owning my own pen testing company and working for other people prior to that, I've worked alongside of some of the guys that had all the certifications. I mean, they were like wallpaper.
Yeah.
So, you know, and they had all these crazy certifications, and I kind of felt like, well, I have some too, but I don't have as many as this guy. And I kind of felt down a little bit on myself, but working side by side with them, they had no idea how to put the knowledge from their head to their fingertips and make the magic happen. And that's a big problem in this industry. Anybody can go read a book and memorize it and take a test or get training and, you know, for that specific test and pass it. You know, you see a lot of these training places or certification bodies guaranteed to pass first try, whatever. You know, so for me, the certifications are good because they get you into HR. They get you past the door. But if you're not able to execute those things that they're expecting of you because of your certifications, you're going to be on the unemployment line real quick. So what I used to do with my firm when I hired a new pen tester is I would look at their resume, of course. I mean, if they had the certifications, come on in for an interview. I would sit them down in my conference room. I'd give them a laptop and I'd have a standalone box on that same network. And I said, hey, hack this machine. That was really easy. It was like equivalent to Metasploitable 2. Okay. I just wanted to see if they actually had the knowledge in their head to the fingertips on the keyboard. And I would say, take as much as you want, take as long as you want. I'll check in on you every hour. There's bathrooms down the hall. There's food and coffee over there. Knock yourself out and I'll be back.
That's an awesome verification process.
And you know something? I got to be honest with you. I would hire the people, even if they couldn't actually hack the box, I would hire the people that tried. Because I would look at their bash history and I would check them out and make sure that they actually tried. There was a lot of guys that when I came back in the first hour, they were no longer in the conference room. They left.
Wow. Yep. Wow.
They couldn't do it. They left. I checked their bash history and they ran an Nmap scan and then they left.
Yeah.
So, you know, I don't know what that tells you about certifications, but some of them had some pretty impressive stuff.
Yeah. I think that's a huge breath of fresh air just to hear, you know, that concept. So when you have all these students who are going through Pen Tester University and what have you found? Are they preparing to go to find a job or is it a 50-50 split? Are people looking to go and start their own companies? What are their objectives when they come to you?
Yeah, you know, I was actually shocked because I thought it was going to be more people going just to go look for a job. And it's actually a pretty 50-50 split. And I encourage everybody at some point in their life to try to start their own business. It's hard work. It's way harder than pen testing, I'll tell you that. It is grueling. It is time intensive. You will not do well for the first 5 years. That's the general rule in any business. I don't care if you're an ice cream salesman or you have your own pen testing firm. Business is cutthroat and it's rough. Now, the thing about that is never go into business, obviously, you know, without any kind of money to back you up because you got to pay bills. But it's been 50-50 and I'm always happy to help my students even go a step further and they stay on for the, you know, the coaching program and I help them start their businesses. Now, I can't tell you every single law in every single state and every single country, but I can give you the fundamentals and the basics of, you know, how to start a business, what kind of documentation you need, you know, contracts, you got to contact a lawyer, you have to have a certain kind of insurance. You know, this is how you go and chase leads and get customers. Because I mean, myself, when I had the pen testing firm, when I first started out, we didn't have big clients. We had small places and it was so hard to get those small places because back then, really, nobody knew anything about cybersecurity, hacking, protecting data, that nobody cared, to be frank. But you know, eventually we got big clients like Walmart, right. Target, Radio Shack. I mean, Symbol Technologies. We got a lot of big clients, and it just took time. But yeah, it's a 50-50 split. And I don't discourage anybody from going try to get a job. You know, some people just don't have the interest in starting their own business. And so I push them to do that. It's all about their passion. So the ones that want to start their business, I'm happy to help with that too.
That's an amazing value that you offer there. And how many years have you been in business yourself in the IT penetration testing realm?
I think I started, and I have to look at the corporate registration paperwork, but it was about 2002, maybe 2003.
Okay.
So, you know, I just went full steam ahead. Yeah. In comparison, I think like it was yesterday, you know, but apparently not. you know, so I mean, I went full bore. That's all I wanted to do was work for myself. I was so tired of working for other people. I was so tired of office politics and, you know, having seven bosses. I mean, it was just like that movie Office Space. You know, I had like seven bosses every day and none of them would talk to each other, but they all seemed to come find me and talk to me and nobody was on the same page.
Yeah,
I just got tired of it, sitting in a building for 8 hours a day and just staring at the screen. Like, God forbid you wanted to get up and go get a cup of coffee and just take 10 minutes away from the screen. Like, you'd have seven bosses yelling at you. For me, I was kind of like, well, I'm all done with that. I'm going to be my own boss. And so, you know, I went full bore ahead and I was lucky to have success. Not a lot of businesses make it when they first start up. I'll tell everybody that now. A lot of businesses fail within the first 5 years. Like I said, the 5-year rule. You don't make a whole lot of money in that 5 years. So make sure you have savings if that's your niche. If you want to go start your own firm or whatever, make sure you have a nice amount of money to float you by on the slow times. But you also have to be hungry. You have to want to have that business and want to be successful. If you just think that you're going to start a business and call it, you know, XYZ security consulting, you're not going to be like the customers aren't going to come banging down your door like they do Kevin Mitnick's, right? He already had that name. He had that background. He had that persona and all that media coverage. It is not easy, but it's worth it. It is worth it. If you can stick it through and it's something that you want to do, I encourage it.
Tell me, what are some of the signs within students that you see in them, or the character traits that you've seen exemplified, where you can look at them and look at some of the things they do and say, okay, this student is going to be successful most definitely. There's no way that they cannot succeed because they have all the traits. What are some of those character traits that you notice and those getting started in the field?
Sure.
And positioning them for success.
Yeah, that's a super question. What I really look for is passion. That's primary, number one. I don't care if you don't know anything about computers or if you're, you know, the next Kevin Mitnick. I really don't care. I want to see that passion in somebody. I want to see that they won't give up when obstacles come in their way, because this whole business is an obstacle, one after the other after the other. I want to see critical thinking, you know, not holding somebody's hand 24/7. I want to see that they actually make decisions on their own, whether they're the wrong decisions or the correct decisions. The point is making the decision on your own without saying, how do I do this? 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 So we kind of take a real different approach to training. You know, I'm there for you 24/7, but at the same time, I want to see you actually doing the work, and I want to see you making critical decisions by yourself. Also dedication. Dedication is huge. I mean, if you can't dedicate an hour out of your day every day to train at least 1 hour, maybe this is not for you. You know, and I'm upfront and blunt with people. If I really don't see those traits inside of them, I'll tell them, hey, you're wasting your money. Yeah. Because unless you can get to this point by this time, maybe you're not cut out for it. You know, so I've done that with students, and sometimes they don't like it. But those are the cold, hard facts. I mean, you could take as long as you want, but just show me the dedication and the passion. You have to train at least 1 hour every single day, 7 days a week. I don't care if it's Sunday, Saturday, Friday, it doesn't matter. You know, take that hour and spend some time doing some reading, some practicing, watching some videos, whatever. But just keep going and keep pushing.
And I have a question from Alex. And he says, is the training by Penn Test University online in class or both? I live in Huntsville, Texas.
Hey, Alex, good question. Yeah, no, the training's all online. And kind of how Tu and I are doing this call right now is how we do the one-on-one coaching. You know, it would be impossible for me to fly around everywhere and hold little training seminars. First of all, it would be crazy expensive. And, you know, I'd have to charge a lot. And I don't want to charge a lot to people because I want to see everybody, no matter what bracket of income they have, be helped. Yeah, it's all online. You could do it whenever you want. Website's obviously open 24/7. So, you know, of course we set up the coaching calls via a calendar app that's built into the website. So you set it in your time zone and it translates to mine. It sets it up in the calendar. It sets up the call. It emails you the initial details about, you know, the Zoom call that we use. Zoom is a software. It's all web-based. And then we just go from there. We could share screens. We could, you know, do all that stuff. So if you're stuck and you're like, hey, I can't get past this point, you could either reach out via email or you could set up the call. And that's all included in our Platinum membership.
That's awesome. That's awesome. So new beginners can receive hand holding if they so need it to advance to the next level.
Yeah, if they need it. But that only goes so far, right? I'll help anybody with anything. It doesn't really matter. But then the next time around, I want to see them do it on their own until they get really stuck. And then I kind of wait and see if they can dig themselves out of the hole. Because here's the thing. When you're pen testing as a professional, whether it's for yourself in your own firm or you're working for a firm, nobody's going to be there to hold your hand. And you have to be able to dig yourself out of holes or get to the next step, think outside the box, whatever you want to call it, to keep moving forward. Otherwise, you know, your boss is going to be like, well, I mean, we hired you to do this stuff. You said you knew this stuff. And then, you know, like you can't really necessarily always turn to your coworker and say, hey, I'm stuck on this. Can you help me? You know, he may help you the first time or two, but then after that, it's going to be like, it's either you got it or you don't. You know, so I will hold your hand in certain aspects, but I want to see where you're breaking down at. And I kind of want to see how you try to figure out your own way out. But if you still can't, then of course I'm going to help. I mean, that's my job. That's what I do. But the next time around, I want to see you do that kind of on your own.
Absolutely. And Alex asks, what's the cost? And you know what? And as you answer what the cost is, kind of go through, is it a single program or is it multiple programs?
Sure. So we actually, you know, it's kind of messy, but we have three different ways that you could sign up to our stuff. You could buy the courses individually and you get email support, you know, which is up to 24 hours between tickets, you know, for a response. Usually it's way less than that because I'm glued to the computer like all day. So, you know, and if my computer is not lighting up, it's my phone that's lighting up or whatever. So you could sign up for the courses individually. They range in price from anywhere from like $100 to $199, I think one is. We have two different memberships too. Now the memberships is kind of where you really get more bang for your buck, right? So we have the silver membership, and that doesn't really include any coaching. It doesn't include the one-on-ones. It doesn't include, you know, any of that stuff. And I think that's actually on sale right now, if I'm not mistaken. I actually can't remember the price of that one, to be honest with you. Nobody really buys it, but it's an option there for them. And then the best bang for your buck really is the platinum membership, which is $149.99 per month. You could pay via credit card or PayPal, whatever you prefer. And you could cancel any time, right? So there's like no contracts. You're not locked in for 6 months, a year, you know, whatever. If after the first 30 days, you're like, man, I hate this, you could either cancel it in your student dashboard or you just shoot me an email and I'll cancel it out for you and send you the confirmation. So it's not a big deal. But if you break it down day by day on an average of 30 days, it's like $5 per day. I'm pretty sure most people can go into their couch cushions and find $5.
Right. Right.
So,
or know, Starbucks. Or
cut back on us.
They cut back.
Right? Yeah. Right. But think about it. And I understand that, you know, a lot of people have tight budgets and that's cool. It happens. It is what it is. But think about it this way. You're paying a little bit of money now, $5 per day, pretty much, to learn something where you have the potential to do great. And like I said, it doesn't happen overnight. You're not going to make $100,000 after you're done with our program. It's just not going to happen. But you work towards it, you spend the time, and you could get to that $100,000. You could get to that 150, 180. I mean, there's some guys that are making well over that. I'm not sure how, but they are, you know, and the other thing that we try to do at Pentester University too, for the students that graduate all the programs, and even after you're done and you're, you know, you're not part of the membership no more or anything, you're on my LinkedIn, you're on my, Facebook groups and stuff like that. And just like Tu said, you know, he's got some recruiters in the group and whatnot. I try to always match up my students with potential, you know, recruiters or job openings. I've got a lot of friends still in the industry that own their own companies, and I try to hook them up, you know, with potential students that are, you know, done real good and whatever. So I also try to do that for people too. It's not really job placement, but I'm always keeping a lookout for people.
That's a lot of value. That's a huge value.
I really try. I just want to see everybody do well. And that's my main focus.
Yeah. Yeah. And there's a lot of room in this industry for everyone to succeed.
Yeah. And that, you know, just to touch on that, that's the other thing too. You know, when people are starting to, I've heard recently people saying, well, the IT security crowd's overrated. It's oversaturated. It's not. I mean, just look on the news. Every single day there's a breach somewhere about, you know, this company got their data stolen and this company got DNA data stolen, like Ancestry and all those DNA sites, you know?
Exactly.
I mean, think about it. The market's huge. If you wanted to, and there's many assets to pen testing, right, too. Like there's little niche markets like web pen testing, which I guess some of you guys now call, was that bug hunting or something? You know, there's network pen testing. There's so much different stuff that it's never going to be oversaturated. It's only growing. For every, you know, one cybersecurity professional that's out there doing their thing, whether a pen tester or whatever, there's like 500 hackers in some country, you know, exactly. Or some 13-year-old kid launching scans from his parents' basement. You know, it's always growing. It's never going to go away. And I was last year, I was looking at some projected forecasts. I think I actually have that on the front page of Pentester University.
Okay.
About how fast it's actually growing and what it's projected to be by 2021. Now, I know obviously since last year we're 1 year closer, and there hasn't been any market data that I've seen so far that came out to, you know, deny or add to those results. But I mean, it's growing so fast that like there's really a shortage of pen testers. So when people tell me that it's oversaturated, I ask them where,
you know,
and usually it boils down to their resume and why they can't get a job. And so, you know, that's on them. It's not oversaturated, but not by any stretch.
And the last numbers I saw for the U.S. is there's 350,000 vacant jobs in the U.S. and across the world, there's 1 million vacant jobs. So, yeah, you know, cybersecurity professionals are in demand all over the world,
all the time. And it just keeps growing. Those numbers keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And to be quite honest with you, it was not even close to that 20 years ago when I first really started gaining traction. It was tough if you wanted to find a job. And that was also the other thing of, you know, why I said, you know, I'm just going to go start my own business and create jobs, because there was a shortage of jobs back then. I mean, you know, anybody that had anything to do with anything in cybersecurity had those jobs already. So it was really tough to break into. But man, I got to tell you, now it's easy. I mean, it's not easy. I don't want to, that's maybe something I shouldn't have said. It's not easy, but there's more availability there now for you to break in and get into it. And everybody says, well, this is just a buzz. It's just the hot topic right now. It's not. Every single day it's growing. I promise you, this career will be around long after I'm gone and you're gone and everybody else is gone. It's not going anywhere. Technology is growing rapidly. And for everything that's new that comes out, somebody's going to hack it. I mean, it's just the inevitable.
And Mike says, how do we sign up?
Hey, Mike. You guys could go to the website. We actually have a 7-day free trial on there for most of the memberships. So you can go on there and, you know, go through, let's see here, pull it up on my end here. I think it's, let's see.
And I see the 7-day free trial right there on the site. Let me click on that.
You can actually click on that. I don't know if you're screen sharing to everybody or whatever. You can,
everyone can see it. And you have your silver pass, platinum pass, and your corporate pass there.
Right. Yeah. The corporate stuff is what I deal with, you know, larger companies like 25 or more people. But there's a 7-day trial on both of those. You could sign up. You got to put your payment details in, but here's the thing. So if you hate it in 6 days, cancel it. You know, just either, like I said, contact me or go into your student dashboard and just cancel it. Otherwise, it will automatically bill on the 7th day. So just be aware of that. But if it did bill and you said, hey, you know, I forgot or whatever, as long as it's within a day or two, I'll just refund you your money. No big deal.
Absolutely. And I have a... Let's see. Let's look at Suave R. Walker. He says, first time tuning in. Great show. Question is this a difficult transition for a person with a professional mental health background? I'm really intimidated by technology, but I am interested in it.
Hey, Suave,
so what
welcome.
Would you say to Suave?
Yeah. Hey, Suave, welcome. That's a really good question. You know, I don't think so. I don't know how long you've been tuned in for, but earlier I mentioned we do have some doctors that were DOs and had their PhDs and stuff transition from being a doctor to cybersecurity and actually excelled really well. I think that anybody can do this if they just put the time in, the dedication, and really just crack down on it and get after it. I think that anybody could do it. Don't be intimidated by technology. No, here's the thing. There's a ton of buzzwords that fly around the internet and the whole world that, you know, cloud this and whatever that. I mean, the cloud really, let's think about it, it's somebody else's computer. It's the simplest way about it. But what we do at Pentester University is I break it down to the necessities, to the basics for you. I'm not going to use fancy buzzwords and whatnot. And if I do, I explain what they are and, you know, why. I don't want to see anybody get confused and left behind. So we try to break it down into the simplest form possible. So no, I don't think it's a difficult transition for anybody. We've had cops, doctors, lawyers, truck drivers, had a flight instructor, believe it or not, which was kind of odd, you know, try to get into cybersecurity. So yeah, the door is wide open. Anybody's welcome into this field. And just don't be intimidated. You know, like I said, there's a lot of places out there that use all these crazy buzzwords to make themselves sound fancier than they are. We don't do that.
That's pretty encouraging to hear.
Thank you.
And so we have Wilson Ray who says, there are a lot of job postings, but they are requiring 5 years of experience. even for analysts.
Yeah. And that's the thing. So, I mean, like I said before, it's the 5-year rule. It's dependent upon everybody's different, but it's generally the 5-year rule. So if you got to start off in IT help desk support, you know, answering telephone calls or trouble tickets and running to a, you know, an end user's desk and replacing your keyboard or rebooting their computer or whatever the case may be, that's what you got to do. You have to put in some experience, but make sure your bosses know that you're trying to upgrade yourself into being an analyst or security consultant or, you know, penetration tester or whatever. Always strive to let those bosses know that, hey, this is my interest. You know, so like in your resume, you could put that your future goals are, you know, penetration tester or a cybersecurity analyst or whatever.
Exactly. And Suave says, thank you, very encouraging to know.
Oh, sure. Absolutely. Anytime.
Awesome. Awesome. And so in your being in the cyber field and, you know, being an entrepreneur in the field, when did you start to see the transition of the cybersecurity actually becoming a significant field, a field that would be around for years to come? When did you start to see that transition happen?
You know, it's really tough to say, because I don't remember a point in time in my career where it became the aha moment that everybody's like all up on cybersecurity. I will say that in the last 3-4, well, maybe even 5 years, it started to become more popular, more recognized as something that needs to happen and needs to be done. You know, like I said, when I started out, companies had no idea that people could hack into their computers. And even today on a small mom and pop shops, you know, with less than 10 employees, let's say for instance, you know, maybe they make widgets or maybe they're an accounting firm or something. They don't have to meet, well, maybe not an accounting firm, but they don't have to meet any federal compliances like PCI, DSS and SOX and all that stuff. Let's just say they just make widgets. They think, what's the chances of me being hacked over, you know, say for instance, Walmart that's making similar products.
Right.
The idea is that, it's a misconception. And the reason being is because as an attacker, I would go after the small fish that likely don't have a cybersecurity team. They likely don't get quarterly or monthly or bi-yearly or even yearly annual audits. So I'll stay better hidden there and maybe use their network to launch attacks against other networks like a proxy, or maybe I'll steal their company information and sell it to the big box store or sell it to another company or sell it to China or, you know what I mean? So they don't really get it, but yeah, it's just one of those things. I know that definitely within the last 3 years, I think it really started with the Ashley Madison hack.
Yeah.
The Yahoo hack that they just admitted to that happened 5 years ago.
Right.
you know, I mean, now it's really gaining traction. Now it's really on fire. And, but there's no signs of it slowing down. I'll tell you, I mean, I've read everything I can, talk to all the industry experts that I can, recruiters, companies. You know, to be honest with you, sometimes what I do, and this is for my students at Pentester University, is I'll actually put out my resume on places like Monster and Indeed. And I'll actually go to mock interviews with other companies looking for pen testers. And I kind of see what they're looking for, how the interview process goes with different companies, different niche markets.
Yeah.
See what the pay scale and ranges are. I mean, obviously for me, you know, my pay scale would be much higher than say somebody just starting out. But just to get that like top of the market range to see kind of where things are at. And I obviously never take the job. But I do it as a test so I can let my students know, hey, this is what's changed. This is what's going on. This is how to do an interview. This is, you know, we actually have a course on, which I did like a live webinar on, gaining your employment in cybersecurity too.
Okay. That's awesome. That's all. And you know what, that's one of the courses we're going to be giving away, here in a couple minutes. Your gaining employment, the webinar replay. Is that the one you were referring to?
Yeah, sure is. It was actually pretty good because we had some people ask some questions there. I kind of walk you through what a resume should look like, what it shouldn't look like. Everything from the initial email or phone call you get from either the recruiter's office or the company itself, kind of all the way up to the interview and what to expect, what to do to better your chances to try to nail down that job.
Absolutely. That's awesome. And one more question before we get ready to wrap up, and we definitely got to have you on again. I mean, you're a huge wealth of knowledge.
I appreciate that.
What you're doing at Pentest University is amazing. Just learning about the fact that you're not necessarily preparing anyone specifically for a certification, but really giving them the skills and the knowledge they need to either start their own company or, you know, be able to hit the ground running in a company and prove that they can do what they say they do. I mean, that's not a common, that's not commonly promoted in the industry right now. So that's definitely an amazing thing.
Thank you. I appreciate that. That's we really tried to be much different than everybody else and kind of separate ourselves from the pack and just do our own thing. And that's like what you do when you start a business, you know, you separate yourself and you just kind of feet to the ground and do your own thing and plan it and just hope that it's going to work out. And so absolutely, we've been real lucky, and I appreciate that.
And when someone comes to you at Pentest University, what do you expect them to be aware of, or are there any prerequisites for them coming to you?
Technical prerequisites, no. The only thing that I ask of people is that they give the training a shot. And that's kind of why we do the 7-day trial. The other thing that we do a little bit different than most other people is I actually space out the lessons and modules and relevant groups every 5 days. And what that does, one of the biggest problems I've seen is information overload. And this is why people get really super frustrated with their training. And this is often, more times than not, why they quit. Information overload. You know, they suck it in too quick, and then it just makes things start to not make sense in their head. So what we do is, in relevant groups, we every 5 days automatically release new lessons and modules to students. So this way, during that time, they have time to really go over the information and then stop and be able to get on a call with me directly and ask me, or send me an email and ask me questions that they might have that maybe they're just not understanding it, you know, the way that we put it out. So it kind of serves two purposes there.
Okay, that's awesome. So we're going to get ready to wrap up, but we definitely have to have you on again. There's so much more to cover.
I'd love to come back. That'd be awesome.
All right, awesome. So we have 15 comments, and we have two prizes to give away. So if you want to throw two numbers out there, and we'll be able to identify those winners.
Yeah, sure. So we had 15 comments. I'm going to go with 2 and 11.
2 and 11. All right, number 2 and 11. You guys just won. In that order, you won the penetration testing class online, and also the interview preparation course of landing that first job in cybersecurity. So I'll identify who that is. And Sean, thanks for coming on. We appreciate it. Looking forward to doing this again with you.
Too. Thanks so much for having me. It was really fun for me. I appreciate that. And I'm always here to help anybody. If you guys have any questions, you can shoot me a message in Facebook, you know, or go to the website. You can email me directly from the website. I'm more than happy to help. I just want to mention, we do have a free 5-part NMAP mini course up on the website on the front page. You sign in with your email address every day for 5 days. There's a new lesson delivered right to your email inbox. So make sure you add that email to your safe list. And then, other than that, the 7-day trial, and I look forward to coming back. You guys are awesome. Thanks for joining us.
Awesome. Thanks a lot, Sean. Have a great evening.
All right. You guys take care. Bye-bye.
All right, everyone. I will take the time to identify the winners and provide you with your code so you can go ahead and get started on that training this evening with Pentesting University. So thanks a lot, guys. And again, every week, Tuesdays at 8 p.m., we're bringing on a cybersecurity professional to help you either get started in cybersecurity or to enrich your already growing cybersecurity career so that you can make moves in the industry and receive valuable insights to allow you to know what you would like to do next and to help you strategize going in that direction. So again, thanks a lot, everyone. Next week, same bat time, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on Tuesdays. Have a good night.